Spirit and sanctification. By the way, all of these class ideas did come in some way, shape, or form from suggestions of people in the congregation. So this one in particular, I was asked, one of the suggestions was a class on sanctification. And so I've enlarged that idea a little bit to include this idea of being filled with the Spirit. And I think we'll see why in a minute. So let's take a few feet, I'll pray, and we'll come after what our meditation on the Word. And the Father, you ask that you would give us a delight in you, a delight in your Word, as we unfold it, we pour over what you have the right, Father, may we see your manifold wisdom and the greatness of your grace. Or fresh with ourselves that we would benefit from it in the way that we intend to, which would leave us bound hungry at your feet with gratitude and love in our hearts. We ask you to leave us in. Amen. Amen. So, the word we're going to get again, if you're note taking, is on the significance of being filled with the Spirit. So you might say, how big an idea is this in Scripture? And so, let me just mention to you, that the idea of people being filled with the Spirit is actually relatively common. I think I counted 18 verses, both Old and New Testament, where we are explicitly told that a person is filled, was filled with the Spirit of God. So let's look at some of these together. First of all, starting in the Old Testament, there are a couple of verses in Exodus. I could have listed another one there. I believe it's in chapter 35. Then the Lord said to Moses, "See, I have called by my name Bezalel, and I have filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom and understanding and knowledge. And his all kinds of skills." Did you know what the context of this is? Remember? Yeah, building the tabernacle. So he's one of the craftsmen. He was designing and building the house of God. He's filled with the Spirit.
I did little things right there.
There are a couple of other. I thought I put the world section. There are a couple of other ones where we're told that a person in the Old Testament is filled with the Spirit of God. The prophet Micah, another time. Samuel. Here at Luke 1, and you'll notice that the rest of the verses that we see here are all in the book of Luke. Or in the back. And what's interesting about that? Anybody? Same author. And if you read Luke, you should read Acts because they are companion. You can see just from this introduction to each one, they are companion works written by Luke. And so you see that Luke is himself as an inspired author. I'm interested in the theme of people being filled with the Spirit. So here's John the Baptist. For he, John the Baptist, will be raised in the sight of the Lord. He will also be filled with the Holy Spirit. In chapter 4, when Jesus, being filled with the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Acts chapter 4, I didn't include all the ones in the Gospel. Peter, as he prepares to preach to them if they need to. And he does preach. And he can unfold to them. He is filled with the Spirit. Acts chapter 4, verse 31. After Peter goes out from the presence of the Sanhedrin, he returns to the disciples who are gathered, and they pray. Peter prays, and then the resulting effect, they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. Now, that the plural there, they, is not just the apostles, it's all of the assembly. The disciples were gathered there in Jerusalem under the ministry of the apostles. Acts chapter 6, therefore, brethren, seek out from among you 7 men of good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. What's the business? You guys remember that? Acts chapter 6. Yeah, the 30 tables. 30 tables, the widows in particular. So we see that they were those men who are filled with the Holy Spirit. There's a concept here. There's a concept that the believers and the apostles have about Christians. Some, and this does suggest that some are not appropriate.
Second. pretty straightforward.
Jesus! So here, John in his gospel gives a very maybe enigmatic statement, mysterious statement, speaking of Jesus. Now, is this John the Baptist speaking here? If you go back and read it, it's unclear. Is this John the Baptist is speaking prior to this? Is it John the Baptist still speaking, or is it the gospel writer, John, who is editorializing that story? But the point is, for he, Jesus, whom God has sent, speaks the words of God. For God does not give the Spirit by measure. The idea here is that he doesn't give the Spirit by measure to Jesus. Jesus was full, when the Spirit came upon Jesus at his baptism, he does go about the work of his ministry on our behalf in the fullness of the Spirit. Without measure. Now, if you want to make further sense of that, you can look at Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7, where in the following, where Paul explicitly says that when Jesus ascended on high and he led his host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. And he uses the language there in Ephesians 4 of measurement. He gave a measure verse 7, but to each one of us grace was given according to the measure of Christ. Yeah. And part of what Paul is saying there is that some are apostles, some are prophets, some are angels, some are teachers, pastors, teachers. Some are an unnamed giftedness, gifted by the Holy Spirit. And but none of us have the Spirit without measure, as we do. We all have been given a measure of the Spirit, and everybody has a different thing. And part of the wisdom of God in that is that as the body of Christ, every member needs every other member, that they might have yet another measure of the gift of Christ. Boy, do you want to talk? I'd love to talk about that point, but I just want to point that out. So the other thing that I want to point out about these verses and the other 17 verses that we could survey. In this week. I just gave you a handful of them in the New Testament, where there's references to the filling of the Spirit, and I just want you to observe that every single one of them is scripted. It's describing the situation or the experience of other people. Right? These are narratives. Each one of these is a narrative. This happened to so-and-so. This happened to Jesus. This happened to him. And then to Jesus, of course. There is a whole block of scriptures that tell us that somebody was filled with the Spirit, but they never tell us what that means. As in Matthew 7, instead of Brother Isaac's question. What does that mean? That's what this is about. What does it mean? There's only one place in all of the Bible where we are commanded, directly commanded to fill the Spirit. And that's what we look at. It is from Ephesians 5, 18 to 28. Let's pluck out some good things from this passage here. First of all, it's important to note that we are commanded. Do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation. The Greek word there is asophia. The Greek word for salvation means sophia. Asophia. Ah is the Greek particle that is negates something. Or negates the negative particle. So to be drunk with wine is to be without salvation. Mm-hmm. do not be drunk with wine, you do it through dissipation. And he's basically said the idea is that he acts like an unbeliever. But be filled with the Spirit. Be filled. This is a command. This is an imperative. You be filled with the Spirit. Believer, he tells you, be filled with the Spirit. But you know what? Is passive. The action is passive. In other words, when the Greek verb is in the passive tense, a passive verb. Passive verbs. Okay, so the subject, which is an active verb, the subject is doing, right? Doing the action. With a passive verb, the subject is being acted upon. Isn't this a strange commandment? Be acted upon by the Holy Spirit. So that you're filled. In other words, it's not something that we do to ourselves. Yet there's a command. In some sense, we are then, the question then, doesn't this, if you're reading this Ephesians, you're reading this, you would rightly wonder, what does Paul mean by it? What does Paul mean by it? Well, let's see the effects of it here. Because the first thing we want to notice in the immediate context is that Paul has specific effects of being filled with the Spirit in mind. If you were to look at this, you've got a main verb here. Okay, here's the main verb, being filled with the Spirit passively. And then all of these I underlined are in the original language. They are called adverbial participles. Adverbial participles. They don't stand on their own. What they do, I can't talk in place sometimes. Being filled with the Spirit. Here's the main verb. And then you have was it four? One, two, three, four, five adverbial participles in a row, back to back, all stacked up. That means in some sense, everything that he says after that is related to what he's talking about. Being filled with the command, being filled with the Spirit. And the best way to understand those is that this is what it looks like to be filled with the Spirit. When one is filled with the Spirit, we are speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing and making melodies in our hearts to the Lord. So this is what he did. If we were filled with the Spirit, then these are the kinds of things that Paul would imagine us doing in the fellowship of the church. And this makes very clear, doesn't it, that when Paul writes to the church at Ephesus, he's not talking to individuals. He's talking to the body corporately. He's telling us, this is what we should be like. This is what we should be about as we are in the church in fellowship with one another, and filled with the Spirit. We're speaking to one another in songs, singing and making melody in our hearts to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God, the Father, and the Lord, Jesus Christ. And then he concludes it there in verse 1:22. Submitting to one another in the fear of God. Okay, so let's just summarize this real quick. If I can. So I'm arguing that this is that these participles and everything that follows the command before the Spirit, all each one of those clauses tells us the effect of being filled with the Spirit. There's a speaking, which to one another. Right? We're oriented towards the other. We're not oriented towards ourselves. We're oriented towards one another, in which we are then singing and making melody. who's going to the other. In our hearts, there is the effect of giving thanks. Giving thanks to God. And then submitting. If you've taken the membership class that I give, you spend most of one class, the second one, talking about what does Paul mean by this, submitting to one another in the context of the book of Ephesians. Well, if we could summarize this, then we could also notice that we must think of being filled with the Spirit as something that has a similar effect to being drunk with wine. Now, we could argue from what other places in the Scriptures say that Paul also intends us to think of being filled with joy. Because what does wine do? But the heart, right? Psalm 104:15, you're looking for perfect. Oh, this part, by the way, is for Jen. All right, if you see fast around, you can go without it if you have a second. Yeah, go ahead.
Is this something that's given to the believer in present tense, or is this referring more so to the mystery portion of the
It is in perfect tense, which is to say it's something that isn't past, it isn't future, it's present ongoing. Present ongoing. So something that we should continually pursue. So, if you want to think about the effects of wine, Psalm 104:15, Ecclesiastes 10:19, those are both places that where Christian problems with the heart makes the wine makes the heart merry, and being filled with the Spirit also fills us with joy. And perhaps Paul is even suggesting here that everything else that follows. These effects of being filled with the Spirit is to be done with joy. And certainly, the part of the work that we know the body is the Now, I wish I had time to flesh that. now is chapter 4, all the way from verse, at least verse 17, all the way to chapter 5, verse 16, no, no, verse 17. So, chapter 4, 17, to chapter 5, verse 17. But this whole section is broken down, if you're looking at the meeting, you can see pretty clearly, there are four therefores. There are four therefores that break down into four different sections. So I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but I just want you to see this. Verse 17 through verse 24, the therefore, and chapter 4, verse 25, through the end of the chapter, which is verse 32. Chapter 5, verses 1 through 6. And then chapter 5, verses 7 through 17. In each one of these, you find it starting with a therefore, which is logically connected to his larger argument here. And I would say that these sections are specifically where he tells us, what does it look like to submit to the brethren inside the church in the fear of God? It looks like what he says here. And he's funny. It looks like, in the first one, not walking like the Gentiles, but instead being renewed in the spirit of your mind. Renewal, which is, of course, associated with the Holy Spirit. In the second section, he talks about interpersonal relationships in the body that are characterized by truth, love that edifies, and grace that forgives. And note verse 20 or verse 30 in particular. To fail in those is to grieve the Spirit of God, which is to say, it grieves the work of the Holy Spirit. Part of what I'm arguing here is this whole section, Paul is talking about the fruits and the effects of the Holy Spirit filling as it relates to the Christian life inside the church. Now, when he gets, as I already said, as he gets to chapter 5, verses 22 through chapter 6, verse 9, that he's talking about submission in the household. What does it look like there? If you are under the power of the Holy Spirit, you're filled with the Holy Spirit, and you're submitting those of them. In chapter 5, 1 through 6, I just real quickly, imitating God as his children is the theme there. It's to walk in love of Jesus Christ, who loved us and gave himself up for us. As opposed to walking like idolaters who are unclean. And he specifically points out in verse 4, is it? Verse 3. Let it not even be named among you as is fitting for saints. Oh, there we go, word again. Holy ones. And holy ones in Paul's letters are people who are under the influence of the Holy Spirit. And that is sort of bringing. And then this last section, if I could summarize, where we are no longer darkness but light. And we walk as children of light. Verse 9. So this is the fruit of the Spirit. Now, some of the Greek things could say light. The majority of these Christians are the Spirit. Again, my point now just is that there is in this section that Paul is really explaining to us, he's working out to us, what does it look like to be filled with the Spirit, both in the life of the church, inside the body, and then in our Christian household. Okay? okay, if Paul is really doing that, if Paul is really, his big idea in this whole section is the work of the Holy Spirit in the life of the church. And I could have gone back further and noted that in chapter 4, verses 7 through 16, right before our section up here, that it's all about gifts and spiritual gifts. Gifts of the Spirit and the effects of the gifts of the Spirit in the life of the church. In verse 16, he summarizes, it is then by what every joint supplies, from whom the whole body is joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body to the edification of itself in love. So even there, Paul is talking about power. The power of what? Well, he knows no other power than the power of the Holy Spirit. And he's talking about, in that section, the effects of the Holy Spirit in giving each one a measure of gifts. So, if I succeeded in this in section 2 on your note-taking, it would be to show you that really, from chapter 4, verses 7 through 16, at least until chapter 6, verse 9, is about the effects of being filled with the Holy Spirit. This is what it looks like in the first place. In the second church, in the Christian household. It's still the, and my point is now, it still doesn't answer the question, how are we filled with the Spirit? If, in other words, if Paul really does go on for the vast majority of, for the huge block of the book, chapter 4, all the way through, and then the rest of chapter 6 is about spiritual work. Right? You might think of it that way. Does Paul really tell us, command us to be filled with the Spirit, and then describe what it looks like to be filled with the Spirit, and not tell us what it means to be filled by the Spirit? Now, this is the stuff of sanctification, isn't it? This is, if you're saying, well, I want to grow in Christ. I want to mature as a Christian. I want to live inside the church in such a way that I'm a mature believer. And my brothers and sisters are experiencing and benefiting from my maturity. We would come to this section of Ephesians and we would say, this is what it looks like. This is what sanctification looks like in this relationship. And I just think that we should, when we get to chapter 5, verses 18 through 21, and he said, be filled with the Spirit, then we should know exactly what he's talking about, how this occurs. And I think he does in chapter 2. And Paul, in chapter 2, and this is an artificial, somewhat artificial, look at everything. The chapter 2, verse 19, this is somewhat artificial. It is artificial. I can't cover the whole book. I would start in chapter 1 if I really wanted to, if we had time to see this and flesh itself out. But I just want to show you how Paul tells us, at least starting in, again, this is artificial, right? But starting in chapter 2, verses 19 and following, all the way through chapter 3, the end of chapter 3, and verse 21. This whole section is the section of the letter where he tells us how the Christian is filled with the Spirit. So let's look at this. Track with me. If I go too fast, going down, but we'll see this first of all. What's the theme? What are the themes is Paul talking about here in chapter 3, or chapter 2, verse 19? In chapter 2, verse 19, Paul here is talking about, he's just introduced the idea that in the church there is this great reconciliation that is taking place. Before the watching world, the Gentiles, they were once far away, but now they've been brought near. They were once verse 12, they were once aliens and strangers from the covenants of promise, but now, and they had no hope, they were without God and hope, but now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near. So understand that, he's talking about the church, that those who once were far away are now being brought near. He's broken down the middle wall of separation, the law that once kept Jew and Gentile apart, so that as if, you know, there were the people of God in the old covenant, and now in the new covenant, Jesus' blood is a great, magnificent breaking down of that separation, so that the two can come together. And Paul says, look at verse 17. And he came and preached peace to you. Who's peace? Who's Jesus Christ? When did Jesus ever go to Ephesus? He did. When Paul showed up, that's the answer, right? Mm-hmm. That's what we're going to see here. When Paul showed up, Christ came and he preached to them. Hold on to that. Talk about hearing the voice of God. In verse 19, so he's talking about this preaching ministry of Jesus, so that it brought those who were far away, brought them near, through him, Jesus, we both have access by one Spirit through the Father. And now he starts describing the church, the greatest thing he does. And in his description here, he describes believers as members of the household of God. And they are essentially stones that are built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. Now hold on to that phrase. On the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. As believers, then we are built together. And Peter uses the analogy in 1 Peter chapter 2. He calls us living stones. Ephesus outside has concrete and black stones. Well, go talk to the stone out there and get those black stones. They have no lightning. They're not animated. But, you know, he's working a metaphor here, right? He's working a metaphor. He's creating an imagery. Now imagine yourself as a stone that's alive, that's connected to the other stones. And you have an imagery in your mind that is very much what Paul's doing here in Ephesians chapter 2, what he was talking about. That we are built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, and Christ being the chief cornerstone, but we're being built together. And then you start mixing metaphors in verse 21. The whole building being fitted together grows into a holy temple. Grows, what the metaphor related to the other injuries and uses of the body. He's taking the temple imagery and he's connecting it to it. He's going to work this out later in chapter 4. He's relating it to the body and the temple. And part of the point is the church is so magnificent, it's so wonderful, that he's got to use all different kinds of metaphors to help us see the whole. Just before he says, the church is one new man in Christ. One new man, one new body. Now, there's also a temple being built up. Well, temples don't grow, right? So he can sort of mix that forth here. And how does this work? It works through preaching, you see earlier, of the apostles and prophets, so that the church grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In whom you also are being built together for the dwelling place of God in the Spirit. So my point in this section, just looking at that survey, you can see Paul's concern is about the work of the Holy Spirit, right? Through some kind of ministry of Jesus Christ, or the work of the Spirit. Well, what does Paul do next? Well, what I want you to notice in verse chapter 3, let me just point out to you in verse 1, for this reason, you can take note of that, right? Because if you're reading that, what question is when you read that?
For what reason?
For what reason?
For what reason?
That the church might be built, that we might be built together, that we might grow to be the dwelling place of God in the Spirit. That's God's great purpose for the church. He's about to tell us that this purpose is extraordinary. It's bigger than you might even imagine. But for the reason of the church being the dwelling place of God in the Spirit, for this reason, for that reason, Paul says what? He says, there, I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, now, the section here, we don't want to be bogged down easily, good, because it's one long sentence, chapter 3, verse 1, all the way through 7. It's all one long sentence. And so you've got a main clause and then all these subordinate clauses. And it's easy to get bogged down and lose track of what he's saying. So let me help you here. For this reason, I, Paul, and then we don't get the verb until. You don't get the verb until verse 7. When he says, of which I became a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given to me by the effective working of his power. Now, Paul often does this. He starts talking about a topic, and his mind is just caught up with the glory and the beauty and the majesty of what God is doing in all of this, and he can't contain himself. If he was a good communicator, he would discipline himself better, and he'd work out all these subordinate clauses in proper sentences. But he doesn't do that because he can't contain himself. When you read it in the Greek, that's the feeling. It's like, oh, hold on, wait, where is it? And you're looking for the main verb, and you can't find it. And there it is, 7 verses later. For this reason, I, Paul, was made a minister. He became a minister according to the gift of grace. He's referring to his call as a minister. Call of Paul. So for the reason of the church becoming the dwelling, and we've got to follow the logic here. In order that the church might become the dwelling place of God in the Spirit, for that reason, first of all, Paul's saying in those first 7 verses, I was called, or I became a minister. In other words, in order for the church to become the dwelling place of God in the Spirit, Jesus called a preacher of the gospel. That's what he's saying. Okay? So, if that's the big idea there in chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. It's a long, complicated sentence, but it's the work of the Spirit in the members of the church starts with the gracious call of God to some. Who will minister the mysteries of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Okay? Now, when we get to chapter 4, verse 11, we see that the work began with the apostles and the prophets, right? And we have to say began. Because the apostles and prophets are gone. How do we know that? Well, chapter 2, verse 20, we're told that the apostles and prophets were the foundation that the rest of the edifice is built upon. Now, you don't build anything on a foundation until the foundation is complete. That's the nature of the foundation. Now, for those of you that are a little more sophisticated, you know, you can cancel over something over. Properly build on something, you lay the foundation, and then once the foundation is laid, then you start building up from there. Now, Paul isn't, in not so many words, Paul is letting us know that the apostles and prophets are the foundation that everything else is built upon. And once they're gone, once the foundation has been laid, who carries it on? Chapter 4, verse 11. Evangelist, pastor, and teacher. Paul here is describing his role as an apostle, in verses chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. When he gets to chapter 3, verse 8 through 13, which is our next section, He says, to me, who am less than the least of all the saints, this grace is given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all to see what is the fellowship of the mystery. Now, the rest of the verses here, in chapter 3, so right now we're talking about chapter 3, verses 8 through 14. He's explaining his role. Now he's explaining his role as a preacher. And what is his role? What's his job? Preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. This is a key phrase. Unsearchable riches. Now this word in the Greek, unsearchable, it literally means untrackable. In other words, you can't track it down. Right? If you get the kids or they let them out the front door and you don't get stay in the front yard, and then you go out there and look for them and they're gone. You're going to track them down, right? You're going to go somewhere to find them. So here's the idea here, is you can't track down the riches of Jesus Christ. And I like the translation, unsearchable. It's good. Unsearchable. But you better believe it, if, you know, if our kids go out the front door and they wander away from us, we're going to track them down, right? Eventually the people find them. When he says here that the riches of Jesus Christ are untrackable, unsearchable, he doesn't mean don't search them. He doesn't mean don't try and track them down. In fact, he's saying, I'm preaching you. I'm making them known to you. It's just, here's the truth. They are so expansive, the riches of Christ, that you can't even comprehend. Now, keep that thought in mind. Keep this concept in practice. So what's his role? His role is to preach the unsearchable riches of Jesus Christ, and the effect that it has is what he explains in verses 9 through 12, I guess. Note verse 10, verse 9 is a mystery, which was from the beginning of the ages, hidden in God, who created all things through Jesus Christ, to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church. By the church. The church has some mysterious, glorious purpose in the mind of God. What is this mysterious, glorious purpose? The church. Says right here, that the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in the heavenly places. Now, if we have time, you go to chapter 6. You hear Paul say, you wrestle not with flesh and blood. You wrestle not with flesh and blood, but with principalities and powers. God manifests his wisdom in the church in such a way that all the ancient and wealth hosts of heaven and the powers, and there's a lot of rich concepts in the principalities and powers. He's referring to the heavenly hosts, but these creatures, these principalities and powers have human servants. And they are the nations. If you look at what Scripture says about principalities and powers, this concept of power, spiritual powers, you recognize that the principalities and powers in spiritual places, they make their presence known on earth in the nations of the earth that are opposed to God and the gospel. In Psalm chapter 2. So our calling as the church is to manifold, to make known the manifold wisdom of God principalities and powers. This is, of course, you can't disconnect this idea of church and the making the manifold wisdom of God known. We can't disconnect it from chapter 2, verse 19, where he talks about the church being the dwelling place of God in the Spirit. Here's part of the mystery. God's going to dwell on the earth. The heavens of heavens can't contain it. He's going to dwell on the earth. He's going to dwell in people. He's going to dwell with Jews and Gentiles. He's going to do that. The principalities and powers are all the while opposing this great plan of God. God is actually redeemed into himself, so that he is their God and they are the people. He dwells with them and they dwell with him. So this idea here in chapter 3 of that through the preaching of the unsearchable riches of Christ, the church becomes what it's supposed to be, which is the dwelling place of God and the Spirit. Yes, correct? Then we get to verse 14. We get to verse 14, where Paul says, again, what does it say? How does verse 14 again? For this reason. What reason? For what reason? One place of God and the Spirit, and subordinate to that is preaching, and preaching of the unbreakable riches of Christ. This is how Christ is accomplishing it, that the church, which is the dwelling place of God and the Spirit, might be make known the wisdom of God. Right? So this is the plan. Here's God's plan. This is what he's working out. How's he doing it? He's preaching. We get to chapter 3, verse 14. What does he say? For this reason. For these reasons. I might add to it. For this reason, he does what we do. He prays. For this reason, I pray. And here isn't like Acts chapter 6. Deacons become necessary to minister to the widows. 2-7 men told the Holy Spirit, give them this work to oversee. Why does Peter say that he needs to do that? So it's not right that the apostles would give off the ministry of preaching and prayer. That's what they've been called. Paul's. All of your Paul's ministry. Preaching and prayer. Why? Well, because the calling is so great. It's greater than Paul in 2 Corinthians says, who is sufficient for this? And nobody's sufficient for this kind of work. This is crazy. So he's praying, but also he just told us. Don't forget about the principalities and powers. The principalities and powers are against this. They don't want to see this happen. Right? So part of what the church is going to face is the temptation to leave off the ministry of preaching the gospel by the apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. There's a danger here. So Paul prays, what does he pray? Look at the Spirit. Okay. He prays for the church, right? He prays for the church, didn't he? He prays for you. What? This means I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you. He is gracious. He And the purpose of it there is to lift them for us, for the people in Christianity, to be strengthened with might through his spirit in the inner man. Strength with might or power. In the inner man. The believer will be strengthened with might in the inner man. Okay, now I want you to look at verses 17 through 19. Verses 17 through 19. Grammatically in the Greek, these clauses, now there's a bunch of clauses, the subordinate clauses, and they tell us how this prayer is. Or what does it look like in this prayer? What does it look like to be strengthened with might in the inner man as the praying and preaching of the gospel is brought to us by the men of Christ that gives us the call? What does it look like? Well, look at that. That Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. In our hearts, that's the inner man there, right? In the inner man, and then he switches to the term heart, which is a little more familiar to us. Then it's that you, being rooted and grounded in love, now Paul refers to some foundation metaphor here, rooted and grounded. Getting back to building up metaphors. That Christ may dwell in our hearts, that we might be rooted and grounded in love. Okay. Who's love? Christ's love. Because verse 18 is critical. It is explanatory. It explains what he means that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you might be rooted and grounded in love. Verse 18 explains what that is. It is accomplished by being able, now may be able, ability. You might have the strength, you might have the power to comprehend. Maybe that's a little anti-thematic. Oh, you thought you were talking about thinking now. Oh, good. Thinking? I thought all of this power and strength and might and Christ rolling in my heart like faith, and it has to do with thinking? Well, what's the connection? I might be able to comprehend with all the things what is the width, length, depth, and height of what? It returns back to the knowing verb, to know the love of Christ that passes knowledge, surpasses, the surpassing knowledge of Christ's love. But when he talks about the wide, long, is it deep in heart?
Yeah.
Right. This here is spatial language, isn't it? Every direction. Every direction. Which is also, doesn't it connect back nicely to this concept here of the background. Like if you could track it all out, if you could just go out in every direction that the love of Christ fills, then you'd be able to track it out. But that's what you mean. It's surpassing. is love. This is the love of Christ for his people is so, it surpasses our understanding. It's beyond comprehension. It is unsearchably rich. And that's what I call grace. It's beyond it. It's beyond our natural capacity to embrace, to comprehend, to know, and to own it. The unsearchable riches of Jesus Christ is delivered to us in the preaching of the word. If it's the preaching of the word, you're doing what it's supposed to do. Paul has to pray because what he's preaching about is untrackably rich. It's unsearchably rich. It's wide, high, long, and deep. And the understanding of it, the comprehension of it, is beyond your natural capacity to do. So he must pray. It must be given to you. You must be strengthened with all might in the inner man by the... strengthened with might in the inner man by the Spirit. In other words, it's the Holy Spirit that makes the long, high, wide, and deep love of Christ, which is ungraceful, it's unsearchable, it is unsearchably rich, but yet the Spirit causes us to comprehend it. He gives us the strength to understand it. And what's the effect of it? When we comprehend the book of the text, Paul says in verse 19, that it is to be filled with the fullness of God. Do you see a connection there? To our topic? Being filled with the Spirit? To be filled with the Spirit. To be filled. Okay, so let me read. To be filled with the fullness of God is, in the mind of the apostle, to be strengthened with all might in the inner man by the power of the Holy Spirit. You see that? It's both the work of the Holy Spirit through the preaching of the unsearchable riches of Jesus Christ. That we comprehend and we know and we own the unsearchable riches of Jesus Christ, for the wide, long, high, and deep love of Christ. Paul, in another way, calls that the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. And this is what Paul is getting to when he comes to the end of the section about his ministry in the church. And concludes with being filled with all the fullness of God. And it is the work of the Holy Spirit through the preaching of the Word that we are filled up with a knowledge of the unsearchable riches of Jesus Christ. That we not only know, but then we are abundantly, when we're filled with the knowledge of it, then we are abundantly propelled by that love, or the power to be propelled by that love, to love him as a friend. Now, we can't go into it that much right now, but if you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, also there's a different way there. In verses 14 to 15, when he chapter 5, in chapter 5 of 2 Corinthians, Paul is talking, he's defending his ministry. What do we know his ministry is all about? Preaching Christ. Here he calls it, he's calling himself an ambassador for Christ. He speaks of the one who knew no sin, he made sin for us that we might be the righteous. And in verses 14 and 15, Paul says, for the love of Christ compels us, because we judge this way. If one died for all, then all died. If he died for all, but those who live should live no longer for themselves. themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. I hope you can see the connection between the two places. It is knowing the love of Christ. That compels us in the Christian life to live not for ourselves, but to live for Him. Knowing the love of Christ is what empowers the Christian to live not for ourselves, but to live for Him. Well, how do we know the love of Christ? How do we comprehend it? And it is that we do five, so we three. We know it. Through the preaching of the unsearchable riches of Christ, when we are strengthened with all might in the inner man by the Holy Spirit. And when we are filled with a knowledge of Christ's love, Paul says, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we're filled with the fullness of God. Now, I could be wrong, I'm crazy. When these readers get to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18, and he says, be filled with the Spirit, with the Holy Spirit, I'm betting this is what they look to understand what he meant by that. That Paul talked about us being filled with the fullness of God, which was a function of the Holy Spirit's work in our life, making the preaching of the unsearchable riches of Christ comprehensible to us, to our feeble minds, so that we then are compelled by the love of Christ to live not for ourselves, but to live for Him. To live for our brothers and sisters in the church, to live for our spouses and children and our servants and masters and our parents. As we see the word God in the book, it is a filling of the Spirit, which is to say a filling up of the believer in the knowledge of Christ, unsearchable God. To the point that we don't want to live for ourselves any longer, but we want to live for Him. Which is to say, we're sanctified. We are brought to we begin to imitate Jesus Christ in His following. Yet we have to come to the chloride that we introduce that Christ loves everything for us. Can we pin that down into an exact expression like that is the way to do the trial cross? Or is this more nuanced in some sense? What's the idea that there's something that's cracked?
Yeah, that's a good question. If I hear what you're saying correctly, what precisely is the content of the preaching of about His love?
Right.
What it is? I think that it ultimately encompasses the whole scripture. Because that is the mystery that is hidden before the age of the beginning, which is God in Christ is reconciling the world to Himself. So that He can, when we look in every passage of Scripture, wherever we are at in Scripture, understand that it is all pointing to that great love of God in the Son of Jesus Christ. It is going to be used in our life by the Spirit to continue properly, to lead us to Jesus Christ, where we will see the love of God, the Father, and the love of the Son, and then enjoy the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, whereby we are empowered to live as we want to live, to live in one thing. Here's a question.
takes the powers and principalities in the spiritual realm. I mean, that's such a good concept. It's so huge and awesome and, you know, shocking. And yet, the way we are able to build out our ordinary lives and fill that out and just the day-to-day submissions in our households and loving each other and submitting to one another in this body, even in our small church, in our small community, in our bird, in this little time in, of, you know, 2019 and the time that we have here in our small lives. I mean,
wow.
It's hard to go from the glory of what Paul is communicating to, all right, dishes and laundry and getting kids to and from school. And it's, I struggle with that in my mind with the ordinariness of the week. I don't remember this great awesomeness of what.
Yeah. And that's why it is so wonderful to read chapter 4 through chapter 6 through 9. And to read what are the really mundane things that we talk about there. You who stole, steal no longer, but rather worship the man who is living, breathing inside of God, that you might have something to give to those who need. And when that little, you're not stealing more, you're working with your own hands, so you have something, a little bit of something to give to someone in need. To think that in that act that the principality and power are seeing the manifold wisdom of God put on display. Now we can't see it, we often lose track of we don't connect the mundane and the normal. But read Philippians or Ephesians 4:17 through chapter 6, verse 9, and it's nothing but mundane things. Nothing. Forgive one another as those as Jesus Christ, as God in Christ has forgiven you. It's that kind of stuff. Putting on the display of the power of God to save sin. It's something that the principalities and powers don't like. But so that when we forgive others as God in Christ has forgiven us, we're showing the light. We don't see the light of God and the truth that comes in grace through him. And Paul, does in chapter 5 as he works it down in near our verses here, he says, you were once darkness, but now you're light. And he's contrasting these two kingdoms, the kingdom of darkness, the kingdom of light. We were once completely under the power of darkness, but now we've been brought out into the light. How do you know? We love the brother. We don't let the sun go down on our behalf. And all kinds of ordinary things. So, your point is perfect. That's the love of Christ compelling. Paul talks about himself as loving Christ. That's what it looks like. What does it look like to be compelled by the love of Christ? Don't put your hands because you have something to give to somebody. Give it to somebody. Forgive other people. Don't use your mouth as a weapon. Use it to build people up in love. It's really mundane. It's really simple. It looks like wives submitting to their husbands and husbands loving their wives as Christ loves their church. Parents and children obeying the parents and the Lord. Servants serving their masters, not as men please, but as those who are working work for God, you know, what seems to please God. It looks like that. That's what it looks like. Yeah. Not too many good assignment on some of
these. But the truth is, when you read those, none of those things are gifts or creative. We can't do that. All of us will be able to do it. Even those simple, mundane things that children submit to their parents, your husband, your wife, speak to their mother, and then your relationship will be ready. You don't get that apart from us. But for all of us, we put that out.
Now, thank you for that. That helps remind me just now what I think Paul like he is giving at when he talks about the fullness and being filled. It isn't spatial, maybe this helps come back to your question. It isn't a spatial filling so much. And when we think of ourselves as these empty vessels that need to be filled up, and then what does that mean? Now, I think if he's talking about it, is using spatial language, but he means the spatial language to be applied throughout all the spaces of our life. So in other words, being filled with the Spirit is having the Spirit work the love in our heart by the gospel. So that in the fullness of life, in other words, in every moment of life, every situation of life, we're not lacking the powerful effect of the Spirit. We're not lacking the strength and the might in our hearts of the inner man to not love ourselves, but instead to love other people. And so it isn't so much the Paul imagines us here being like cups that we need to fill up. Well, I mean, maybe that's the whole thing. You know? So we have, you know, in this situation, I can, you know, the Spirit empowers me to, you know, fulfill the calling of that moment to do it in a way that honors the glory of God. I think it's more in terms of a filling in the sense of being in fellowship with the Holy Spirit by the power of the gospel, beholding, knowing, and adoring the love of Christ for us, so that moment by moment by moment, we just long believe in the same direction that we have. We have what it takes by the Spirit to meet the fullness of all of us. Permeates. That helps capture that. The way I'm thinking about this. That permeation through the fullness of life, where in other words, that we're not in fellowship with the Spirit of one minute, in reading the Spirit of empty. Fellowship reading, the latter is the fullness of it, where we are the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. With Christ, the power of God, and permeates all of life in every circumstance. So I could be, that's my thought about it. Telling there's no section of our life that we are categorized.
Right.
There it is. That's what it's doing. Pray for and look for and hope for
in the matter of the Spirit, where specifically a specific moment, and what must have been meaning for continually what the Spirit is doing, and what the Spirit is doing to be the moment. Yeah. And he needs it here in the sense of
captivate,
and that's often how the word is translated in other words. Captivate. I am so captivated by Christ's love, I don't want to think about it again. There's nothing greater than thinking about the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Or the love of Jesus Christ. In other words, there's no better thought. And so to truly know his love is to own it. If I truly know it, and this I think goes back to the question, is to truly know it is to be captivated by it. And so if when it comes to obedience, when it comes to me not living for myself, the answer isn't. It might be, and there are an appropriate way to look at things like spiritual discipline and you know, buckling down. I got to buckle down. I'm not serious about it. I'm not selfish. I'm loose with my obedience. There's nothing wrong necessarily with doing it and thinking that way. Like what I need to do is just obey, right? What I already know. But ultimately, what we need is to acquire by the power of the Holy Spirit a captivation with the Lord.
Yeah. Yeah, because I'm just like, if I don't feel captivated by the love of Christ, then I'm not excusing myself not to be, to carry out an unforgiving spirit or to steal things or to not love brethren. I mean, oh yeah, I just don't feel like this. And I don't feel captivated right now, so I can wait to obey until I feel captivated. No, we don't get to do that. I believe help and unbelief. I believe I should do that, but I've got all this unbelief that so that I'm really sorry. That's usually where I find myself. And the answer to it, to actually being captivated so that by the love of Christ and knowing that the way Paul speaking of it is through the work of the Holy Spirit, the work of the Holy Spirit through the preaching of Christ. Another point, where is Paul preaching Christ from? What part of life? When Paul comes to Ephesus and he's preaching Christ, where is he preaching Christ from? What part of Scripture is he preaching? Well, when he came to Ephesus, was he, what part of the Bible do you think he opened up to? And he said, oh, our sermon's up to the Holy Spirit. And that's the gospel of
the Old Testament.
They looked at the scriptures of the Old Testament. So he's preaching Christ, he's searching for Christ, John, he's preaching the Old Testament. Okay? Very important. So the filling of the Spirit becomes what is connected to the ministry of the apostles and prophets, the members of the preaching of Jesus Christ and crucified, whereby through the prayer, the preaching and prayer of the people, the minister of the Lord there, that the Spirit of God the Father is hearing those prayers so that the saints are strengthened. How? He says, therefore, my beloved, please, my beloved, yes, please, delight in what yourself, but I say, the cup of blessings which you bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which you break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we, though many, are one bread and one body, for we all partake of our own body. Now, Paul really does get to, in his characterization of the word supper there, Thank you. think when he talks about the fullness of God and being filled with the Spirit, it also means being connected to the rest of the body, right? You also have the Spirit. And certainly when he says don't grieve the Spirit of God, he's talking about don't do things in your relationships that drives other believers away. Why do you do that? They have the Spirit. And that the work of the Spirit in their life is for you. It's the gift of Christ, not for them. It's the gift of Christ for you. And so part of this fullness has to also include the fellowship in the body with other believers who have a measure of the Spirit, have a measure of the gift of Christ that we lack. And the only way to be full of the Spirit in that sense is for the body to be one. This is another big thing that the body.
Yes. Would the preaching, the mechanism of being filled with preaching, is that separate from the individual reading or hearing?
That's a good question. I don't think that Paul is going to quibble with people looking through their own private devotion as a means of communion with the Holy Spirit, who can use our reading of the Word to deepen our knowledge of Christ. I think he's going to, and I'm going to talk more about this next week, that there's something unique about preaching. There's something unique about it. And the first thing that's unique about it is that I believe it's a passive in some sense. I'm receiving. It's something's being given to me. But it's not coming from within me. It's coming from outside of me, which is what the gospel is. God comes from outside of us, coming down to us, to give this ministry of reconciliation. And so he is using people who he's using mouthpieces who are speaking for him so that we will be in a posture to receive. Because that's the first thing we need to do. We need to quit saying, first we need to get off, first of all, saying, well, I think this, and I think this will be that. And maybe you will go, no. Part of our posture that when we come under the Word of God to be. And so there's something unique about preaching, which I'll talk about next week. And it's not just exclusively about another aspect of it is when you think of this TV or an act chapter that we Philip the evangelist needs to the Ethiopian Venus on the road, and then the chariot, and he's reading Isaiah chapter 53. Chapter 52, not just reading chapter 53. He's reading the same chapters and chapters. But in that place where he's reading it, and Philip overtakes him and hears what he's reading, and he asks him if he understands what he's reading. And his response is, well, how can I understand what I see? That's not how I feel.
It makes a lot of sense to me in terms of when I read, I struggle much more than when I read.
Yes. No, and here's the thing. It's the gift of grace is it's people. Right? And even before we talked about the measure of Christ's gift, it's not, and we often think of the gift of the Spirit in terms of the function, the administration, the government. Or help, or mercy, or whatever it might be. In Ephesians 4, the gifts are people. In other words, the gifts come through people. First of all, there are apostles, and prophets, and evangelists, and the pastors, teachers. They're people. And it's okay, it's okay that some people have a unique gift. In fact, if we understand the interpretation of Scripture well, we all have it right. lot of duties that you're providing. But it doesn't necessarily mean that we all have the same gift of Jesus. And that is part of Jesus' sovereign choice in the way he works out of it. So when we go to Berea in Acts 17, and we're told that Bereans were now in Rome, in the Thessalonians, they listened to what Paul said and they searched the scriptures to see if they were so. I would simply point out there, everybody has the duty to search the scriptures to see if what they're hearing is consistent with the rest of scripture. But it doesn't say that the Berean. It was the Berean believer, plural, right? So there's a community of Christians. In other words, not every Berean doesn't necessarily mean that every Berean is competent in their knowledge of the scriptures to determine whether or not what Paul was preaching was consistent with the rest of the scripture. But that's fine, because they had one another. They had a lot. And so collectively, and this gets into another big issue, which is, how clearly we view the interpretation of Scripture. And in the book of 2 Peter 1, there has to be a scripture that is in private interpretation. In other words, there should be no private interpretation of Scripture. Interpretations of Scripture are singular, with one meaning to Scripture, attached to Scripture. So not any one of us is capable. No one. Not any one person. And I can say this there's never been a single human being except for Jesus Christ who in and of himself has a comprehensive knowledge and of the scripture that comes to we're always using each other. We're always using the body of Christ. We're always appealing to confirm or to help us eliminate bad observations. We're always relying on the body of Christ, which is really the same. We're relying on Jesus and the Holy Spirit that works in the church to understand the body of Christ. And mistakes still made are open to but we're way in a way better position as believers when we're interpreting certain scriptures than when we are a believer. Anybody else that is? Yeah, that, so all of that to say is that we are connected to this more next week. It is that there is an ongoing work of Christ in the church. It is a work of Christ by His Spirit that the Father is answering prayers. And notice the kind of thing that you do that prayer. Every part of the book of Ephesians, in almost every section, when Paul is in his ramblings, you can find a similarity. Whatever he's addressing, he almost always does it. The very next thing Paul addresses, the way that chapter 4 starts in Ephesians is that they call to walk worthy of the calling to the community of God. lives, but also in our households, fathers, we see husbands and wives